These are wonderful days, times where we reflect on what we really actually believe, what is the substance of our life and the substance of going to church every day or every Sunday and serving God. We had Friday, we had a beautiful, Chris brought us beautifully into the presence of the cross. Cross was a revelation, which I believe some of us, we had a new revelation of the cross Friday. That was Friday. Then this morning, Jordan had a beautiful write-out of the events that happened in these last 3 days. Please, I want you to remember that there are 3 days. It was Friday. It didn't go down to Sunday. There was a Saturday as well. So please remember that Saturday is just as important as the Friday. So if I repeat some of the things that have already been said, you will understand that I have to, in order to bring out the point in which we are going to tonight. In Matthew 27, from verse 51, 52, and 53, we found the story of the arrest and crucifixion of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is Friday. It's a beautiful day. The sun seems to be shining in Palestine, and everybody seems to be happy. But the crowd seems to have a bit of problem. There was a view around and the news going around that Jesus, the man who did so much good and who raised the dead and healed the sick, was arrested. The crowd couldn't understand, many of them, why Jesus was arrested. I couldn't understand. If he was doing so much good, why was he arrested and brought before the Sanhedrin? One of the reasons that he was arrested is because he was doing the will of the Father. And the will of the Father, 99.99%, is not the will of man. The will of the Father is different from the will of man. And because Jesus was not doing the will of man, but he was doing the will of the Father, he was arrested. Therefore, my friend, just remember, then whatever you intend to do the will of God in your life, wherever you want God to move and work it in your life, you will always find opposition. You will always find somebody who will tell you that you shouldn't do it and that you should do something else. I remember when I began, when the Lord called me into the ministry and I go and told the pastor, he said, yes, we need somebody to clean up the toilet. Would you please start and go in there? Now, that's the way sometimes things go. You cannot trust those who are in the high power. The crowds were mixed. There were those who were in favor of the Lord Jesus, but there were some infiltrating that crowd, which were, by the way, paid by the high society of the religious leader of the day. And you have always to watch the religious leaders of the day, because they sometimes, they might think they have it right, but they don't have it right. You see, God speaks personally to the individual, and God will make deals with you as an individual person. He will make deals with you as a person, and has got nothing to do with the one in the higher society whatsoever. And therefore, God had made individual determination to the Lord Jesus Christ. And while the crowds were coming together, were coming to the palace of Pilate, where he was interviewing the Lord Jesus Christ, many of them were sorry because he was arrested, but some of them were instigating the rest of the crowd in order that they could get what they really wanted. And what they wanted, it was to get rid of a man who was sent by God on earth to save the people. He wanted to, because if he was going to do that, Well, then you don't need the religious people anymore. If God was sending Jesus, what do you need the executive for? Jesus is the one who you have to follow, and not the executive anymore. The crowd was crying, crucify him. Get rid of him. We don't want him in among us. So get rid of him. And behold, they finally brought him to Golgotha, and they there crucified the Lord Jesus Christ. He died. Did he die? He gave up his ghost, but his spirit. But he gave it up completely. He gave it to his Father. And he said, Father, into your hand I commit my spirit. Because nobody could take your spirit away from you, because that belongs to you, and God has given it to you, and the only person that you can give it to is to the Lord himself. And that's what Jesus did. You see, you have a spirit. I have a spirit. And nobody can take it away from me. They can take my body. Oh, yes, they can, anytime. The body belongs to this earth anyway. But they cannot take my spirit. Jesus' last word was, Father, into thy hand I commit my spirit. Things happened. The crowd, the wind began to blow. And there were a great darkness upon the face of the earth. The wind began to blow, and the clouds came in, and the darkness came into the place where they were gathered together near in Jerusalem, and therefore darkness was there. The earthquake came, and the stone began to they were rent, and that means that the stone themselves were cut in pieces. That was the power of that particular earthquake that came in that day. That's okay, we have heard of all of that. It is written in the Word of God. We have heard it Friday, we have heard it this morning again. It was so very well brought up to us. But there was one thing that did happen as well, and that is that the veil of the temple was torn twine, that was cut in pieces, and the Ark of the Covenant, which has been hidden for so many years, and only the high priest could go and visit it once a year, suddenly was exposed to the whole world, and everybody could see the place where God was meeting with man. But God was coming together. And therefore, my friend, it is a revelation that we must have to find a place where we can come and meet with the Lord God, our Father himself. The mercy seat was exposed. I like that. The mercy seat was exposed. Exposed for me to see, exposed for you to see, exposed for us to come and to be able to receive the mercy of God, not any longer through the high priest that went there only once a year, but now every day, every moment has been exposed and is open, and I can receive the fullness of the mercy of God every day when I wake up in the morning and when I go to bed at night. It is the mercy of God that keeps me alive. It is the mercy of God that brings me to church. It is the mercy of God that makes me going on day after day after day and after day. And my friend, if you think that you have any strength at all, you have no strength on your own. It is for the mercy of God that gives you that strength that you are able to go on day after day and after day for the glory of God. Isn't that true? Not strong, my friend. The mercy seat was open. Friday was over, was done, and was finished. Friday is a lot of problem, isn't it? Every time I go through some kind of a problem, I think I'm on a Friday. Every time I think I'm going through a hardship, I say, oh, it is Friday. It is Friday. Now, you want to know that Friday's there, Saturday's coming, that's what they said, but Sunday's coming, but there is a Saturday in between. There is something there which is extremely important. You see, Friday is what God, through the Lord Jesus Christ, has done for you and for me, opening up the greatness of the treasuries of heaven. Sunday is the victory in which is shown to us by the power and the glory of the Holy Spirit in the resurrection. Saturday, it is the time of rest. It is the time where my spirit will rest into the mercy of God, waiting for the fullness of the resurrection and the answer of my problem for the glory of God and for the betterment of my own life. Saturday is just as important as Sunday, because Saturday is the day of rest, my friend. And I believe that we cannot and we will never be able to come into the fullness of the mercy of God and the knowledge of God, or to receiving the greatness of the things of God, unless we learn how to rest into the presence of God and make our soul in peace with the presence of the Lord. Now, that's what's happening. Two things happen. Please, I like to describe that my own way, okay? Two things happen. Something was happening to the disciples, and something was happening to the devil. It was happening on Saturday, my friend. See, it didn't happen on Sunday. It happened on Saturday. And now the disciples, were getting together because a woman told them that Jesus was not dead, but he was alive. They couldn't actually believe. Peter was one of the first. He just ran down to the tomb and find out that the tomb was empty. But they all got together somewhere. I know that is the way to go, because when there is a problem, generally the church gets together. When there is a problem, families get together, don't they? They discuss the problem. They analyze the problem. And when things are happening, the church will come together. I remember to the time of persecution in Italy, when something ever happened, the church will get together in somebody's house and they will discuss the problem, and they analyze whatever was happening at that time. The disciples were doing exactly the same thing. They didn't have much time to rest. They couldn't do anything because the law said that they were not able to work or do anything else. So they came together and they began to analyze what was happening. And what was happening wasn't very good. Jesus, who was the Messiah, who was supposed to come and deliver them from the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire was still there. Pilate was still the leader of the Israelis and of Palestine, and nothing has really changed. Now Jesus, who was supposed to be the one who would deliver them, he was dead and he was there no longer. Somebody said that he was not on the tomb anymore, but nobody knew much about it. Peter saw that Jesus wasn't there, but he could have been taken away. That was the first thought that came into their mind. So they worked together, analyzing the problems that were happening at that particular time. When they were together, a couple of more disciples came, but they were going home after Jesus died. They came back and they knocked at the door and they said, "Fellas, we saw Jesus. He spoke to us on the way." They couldn't believe it. There was a little fellow, I think it was a little fellow. I don't know why we always think of Thomas being a little fellow, but he could have been a giant as far as I'm concerned. I mean, he could have been a big man, but there was Thomas. He said, "I don't believe a word of you people are saying." I have seen Jesus die. I have seen Jesus give up this ghost. I have seen Jesus buried. And I have seen the soldiers watching the tomb. I have seen all of those things. And I cannot believe that he is alive unless I can put the finger into his hand. There was a lot of commotion in that room. A lot of people seeing a lot of things, and every so often somebody raised their hand and said, can I say some? And then somebody else, can I say some? And the questions were going on. But being Jewish, you know, they talk a lot. They're worse than the Italians. And they talk a lot, and they have a lot of questions, a lot of things are coming up, and therefore they were going through a big period of things. And while all they were anxious, Jesus appeared unto them. How beautiful is that? I can't understand. I sometimes when I have the hardest time in my life, I go in my room and I get there by myself. I want to be by myself. And I begin to think about the Lord and start having fellowship with the Lord. And many times when your heart and your mind is in tumultation and a lot of conglomeration coming through your head and through your mind, suddenly the presence of the Spirit of the Lord comes in. And you know what? As soon as he comes in, he brings peace. And he said to his disciples, peace be unto you. And all of that conglomeration of things, it disappeared because Jesus restored peace into their heart and in their mind. That was what's happening in the church, in the disciples. There was another thing happening on the other side. The devil saw Jesus dying on the cross. He saw he was there, by the way. And he was rejoicing with everybody else that were against him because now they got rid of him. He called up his own lieutenants or whatever you want to call, demons or whatever, and they were having a party of their own. They were right at the gates of hell, and they were having a party, and they were saying, he's dead, we still got the key, and we will have the key now forever and forever and forever. We are the owner of hell. We are the owner of the world. The world has to be subjected to us. And they were having a party. And they were eating and drinking and rejoicing. Suddenly, Jesus appeared in the midst of them. And as he appears in the midst of them, he goes to the devil. And you're not the devil, but he goes to the devil. And he said, give me those keys. They belong to me. I have paid the price. I went up to my Father. And I brought the blood that paid for the price of the people who are living now and those who lived before now or yesterday and those who will live forever until Jesus comes. I pay the price. Give me the key. So he took the key, got into the gate, put the key in, turned the gate. The gate opened up. The devil was trembling on the side. He was going mad or rabies. His teeth were joining together. He was there. He was losing everything now. Jesus had opened the gate. And you know what? He called the people who died before he came. And all of those people who died in the Old Testament, they all came out. And Matthew 27:52 says, and the graves were open, many of the body of the saints that slept arose, and they came out of the gate. And also the Bible said that they began to walk into the city of Jerusalem. Oh, what a joy it was there! The people could see them. They had never met with God, with the saints of the Old Testament, but now they were seeing them. were singing out of the tomb. Now they were out of the tomb. They were walking down the street and they were singing, no longer the slave of sin, but now I am free because I am a child of God. No longer a slave of fear, but I am free because I'm a child of God. And they marched to the city and the people saw them and they rejoiced. And what a wonderful day was that Saturday. It was a beautiful day. Actually, verse 53 that says, and they came out of the grave after his resurrection and went into the holy city, and they appeared unto many. How would you like to see Abraham walking down your street? How would you like to see Ezekiel just walking down the street, or Jeremiah walking down the street and say, hi there, Pastor Neil, how are you? I'm just going up there, I'm going to wait for you. I'm going up because Jesus has opened the door. Now I'm going to be with the Father, at the throne of God, and I'm going to be there for you. Before that, there is always a problem within the church, isn't it? People think they have different way. Well, they were still getting together, they were talking among themselves. While all of that was going on, they had no idea whatever happened there. Peter said, I'm going back. I'm going to go fishing. Bye-bye. Everything is finished. Everything is done. I'm going back fishing. But it wasn't that way. Because Saturday is a day where we rest, and we rest in God. And I firmly believe that we as Christians must learn how to rest in God. I know that it's hard when we are going through the hardship. Don't tell me, I know. It is hard when we are going through a hardship to be able to get to that place where we can rest and rest in God. My friend, we might have a problem, but unless we learn how to rest in God, the resurrection will not come and the problem is not going to be solved. You said, but why? Because when we are resting, we are trusting God, that God can do what he promised to do, and therefore we are just waiting for him to do it. And his time will come and the thing will happen and it will come to pass. My friend, we must learn how to rest, and to rest into the presence of the Lord, and to rest in God. Then the time went over. Saturday was passed by. Sunday has finally come. Here is the place where the Sunday, here is the day in which we are celebrating today. It is Easter Sunday, the Sunday where Jesus arose, and he was in and he was alive and alive forevermore. There was that particular Sunday, the Saturday was over, and on Sunday, the first thing that Mary thought, it was to be able to go down to the tomb and to anoint Jesus, to give him a proper burial, because that was the way it was going, still thinking that Jesus was dead. And so she was giving him the burial and giving the proper burial. She went to the tomb with all of her paraphernalia in a basket. She probably wore on her head, because generally that's what they did, the basket on their head. She walked down to the tomb, and when she got there, she saw that the tomb was empty, the stone was rolled, the soldiers were arguing among themselves what happened. They couldn't figure out what kind of an excuse they were going to give to their own bosses and officers, and therefore they were arguing. Mary peeked into the tomb and she saw that the tomb was empty. She heard somebody walking in the back, and she turned around, and as very nicely was said this morning, She realized, she thought that he was the gardener, and she said, "Sir, if you have taken it away, please let me know where he is so I can give him a proper burial. All I want to do is to anoint him." It was so important to be anointed, and it's so important. Okay, you go there later to be anointed, and then there he comes, and she didn't realize that it was Jesus. And as we heard Jesus call her name, she recognized the voice of the Lord. She turned around and she wanted to rush to him because he was alive, and the joy and the excitement was so great. And she wanted to put her hand around him, and she wanted to hold him. She wanted to bowed before him. She wanted to do something. When you are excited, you want to do something. You don't know what you're doing, but you want to do something. And she wanted to do something, but she couldn't do anything because Jesus said, "Hold on, woman, I haven't gone to my father yet." But he gave her a message, and that it's important. He said, "Go to my brethren and tell them that I am going to be to go to my father and to their father. And when you're going off to them, let them know that I am alive and I'm going and I will meet them again." What is the message that Jesus gave to Mary? "Go to my brethren and tell them that I am alive. I am coming to you here today, and I'm telling you Jesus is alive. He is alive. You might not think so, but he is alive. You might go through a problem, but he is alive. You might go through a Friday, but he is alive. You might go through a Saturday, but he is alive." And the message is the same. 2017 years later, the message is the same. Jesus is alive. Jesus is alive. Jesus is alive. And she went to the disciples and she told them that Jesus was alive. And then all the thing that went on, and again, Jesus appeared to his disciples. He told them, he showed himself that he was alive. And then he told them to go to the world and tell them that he is alive. Is he Jesus alive for you today? Are you leaving on Friday? Friday is over. Today is Saturday, Sunday. Are you living on a Saturday? You're just waiting. Just keep waiting, because Saturday, it's only not far away. The sun will rise and the power of God will be manifested. Jesus told his disciples when he left to tell them that to tell the world that he is alive. By the way, I had a thought. Mary wanted to anoint the Lord Jesus Christ with the oil, and she tried everything that she could, and she couldn't do it. But you know why she couldn't do it? Because Jesus was already anointed. Was it there in Luke somewhere? Where he said, "I am"? He was anointed already. How can Mary anoint Jesus when Jesus was already anointed? That means that there are two kinds of anointing. There is the anointing that is given to you by the Pope, by anyway, whoever is up there. And boy, does he fail. Then there is the anointing that is given to you by the power of the Holy Spirit. That doesn't fail. There is two kinds of anointing. They are there. And today, I want that anointing that come from heaven. Today we want that anointing that come from heaven, because we, as the church of the Father, as the church of the living God, we want to be anointed to let the world not only know by words, but by deeds and facts, that Jesus is alive and he's working today as he was working yesterday. I remember just a little thought. In 1947, 46, after the end of World War II, just a handful of Italian people were left behind. Many had left the Lord, many were died, many were in prison. And just was a handful of people left behind. And when the war was over, the new realm came and the new law came where you could go out and preach the gospel anywhere in every corner. I remember that the message was very simple. In every street corner, in every home, in every gathering of people coming together, the message was the same. Jesus is alive. Jesus is alive. And my friend, if we want to increase in our spiritual life, we must believe that Jesus is alive. If we want to increase in our church, we must preach it out that Jesus is alive. Let us rejoice together today. Let us celebrate together today. I know that when we have communion, we celebrate the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. But today is Sunday. Let us keep Friday on the side. Or let us put Friday and Sunday together. And let us celebrate this victory of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's as we take of the wine, or as we take of the bread, let us also remember that the 3 days are together, and they are working together for the glory of God. And as we raise the emblems before the presence of God, let us also say, Lord, I thank you, because you died, but you are alive. You died, but you are alive. Remember, if you don't die, you cannot be alive. That's it. If you cannot have a victory unless you have a battle. And so today, we'll win the battle because Jesus won the battle for us. Let us all stand for a minute, shall we? Maybe we will come and have the communion together here. We are celebrating. We are celebrating Easter. We are celebrating the death and the rising of the Lord Jesus Christ. Yes, let us all come up here. We'll have it together. Because we are a family, aren't we? We are a family. Yes, please. We are a family.